Start. May I strike a certain personal note, comma, and then go on to other considerations. We, my generation in India, have been conditioned in particular ways by events. There is the background of 2000 years or more. There is the conditioning we have had during the 150 or 200 years of British rule. And then there is the big conditioning during the last 30 or 35 years of what is called the Gandhian movement. We are the resultants of these various conditioning factors. If you want to understand us, you have to understand these conditions factors. That is so about me and my government in India. That applies to the world at large also. We have to understand other people's basic conditioning factors, their past history, traditions, habits, conflicts, etc. And more particularly, the recent history of the last half a century or so. Countries like India and China have millennia of history. It is not an easy matter for me, whatever new knowledge I may gather, to get out of the 2000 years of Indian history. So also with other countries. Yet, in order to understand another country, it is no good looking at it through the spectacles of our own country. If an Indian presumes with his Indian background to judge England or Germany or Russia, he will probably not be objective enough. Now the China leaving our past history, it has been conditioned for more than 40 years, ever since the end of the Manchu dynasty, by continuous trouble. That was China's experience. Take the background of the present rulers of China. It is a background of struggle for the last 25 years. I remember, and some of you may also recall, the Long March in China. Quite apart from its merits, that Long March was a terrific feat. It meant being hunted, being harassed, with many people collapsing and some surviving. They often found a habitat in the mountains and in the caves and lived there for a number of years, organizing themselves. Then came the Japanese invasion. They fought the Japanese invasion. That turned into a world war later. Imagine what a powerful determining influence these factors must have had on the people who took part in a march of 8,000 miles, and whatever the system of government, which is great relief after two generations of disorder. The second is their feeling of nationalism. They feel that their great country, which has been kicked and tossed about from generations, has become unified and strong and can stand up on its own feet and look to any other country in the face. Look at it from the Chinese point of view. I am not for the moment considering communism or anti-communism. I tell you, a Chinese living in Singapore, Laos, or elsewhere, even if he is completely anti-communist, is still proud of China's condition today. He has his nationalist pride that his state, his country, is strong and unified. This is the background of China today. Of course, it did not require my going to China to know all this, but if you keep it in mind, you will understand something of what is happening in China. You and I know very well that in China today, they have got a certain political structure and a certain economic structure. The rulers of China are communists. There is no doubt about that. They have evolved a political and economic system which is partly based on their Marxist ideas and partly adapted to conditions in China. We all know that it is not full-blooded communism, these. It has adapted to their conditions. So now, if you ask me, is there freedom of the press there? With all respect, I shall say that question is rather unnecessary. The whole structure of government there is of a type which is completely different from parliamentary democracy. Whether you can call it democracy or not is another matter. They call it people's democracy. That is an argument which we need not go into. My point is that it is different. We know it. What results it yields, you can partly see now, and ultimately the future will show. It is the future that will show whether the results achieved by the methods they pursue will be worthwhile or not, or have been worth the price paid for them. Each people, and especially these big chunks of humanity like India and China, with long records, as soon as they find freedom to function according to their wishes, are influenced by various external forces, industrial revolution, technological advancement, political ideas, and so on. But if we are worth our salt, we have to stand on our own feet and function in accordance with our own thinking and conditioning of minds. I shall have little respect for India if it followed blindly the American pattern or the Russian pattern or the Chinese or the British. Then it would not be India, but a pale imitation of somebody else. Full stop, over.